This conference will now be recorded.
So is there anything you find difficult during last class, or any of the things which you have discussed till now? Did you find anything difficult you are not able to understand? Or I don't know how you people are practicing at your home. I don't know, right? So anything you want to share, or any kind of discussion you want to do, so we can do it for 10, 15 minutes.
No, Devi.
You do not have any questions or any doubt? Till now?
No.
Okay. So let us discuss then what you mean by a data frame. Okay. Let us discuss it. Discussion. I'm just preparing you people for starting, like, let's say, interview part. So here, from my intention is, from starting onwards, I'll prepare you people for interview. So what do you mean by a data frame in R?
It's a data type, right?
No, answer precisely, Ram. It is not like in interview. How will you say in interview? I'm just making you people comfortable with me, so that you feel the comfortableness or comfortability in the interview also. In interview, if you say it is a data type, right? So like, you what they will tell you. Okay, so be serious while you're like telling something. You are getting my point? Why I'm asking? Yeah, so I'm just someone mute your mic. Okay, so at some point of time, it is I'm getting an unknown sound. So it is a data type available in R, but it is a collection of vector in each variable or each column. Data frame is a collection of vector with different data types available in different column. So each column is a vector in data type. Okay, so you have to say like this: each column is a vector in data frame, and it is nothing but as a SQL table available in any other database, where we have multiple variables or multiple columns having different data types. Okay, so this much is enough. And indexing wise, how you want to index is based on the rows or column you can index it. Okay, so let us start a new data type, or maybe something more into one more data type is there, which is nothing but as a list. Guys, are you able to hear me? Yeah, so we have discussed something, data frame, right? So whenever you try to access a data frame, so you have to give a dollar sign. Okay, let's say we have created one data frame last time, right? So I'm going to the data frame section. Just allow me a few seconds. Okay. And by the time I go through, have you guys practiced the like codes what I've sent you last time? Did you find some time to practice at your home? Yeah, good. Okay, so today we'll see accessing a data frame, how it will be done. Okay, so let's say we want to, so we are here in data frame. So now let's say you want to access or index a particular column in a data frame. How will you do that? So indexing a data frame is nothing but indexing a particular column in the data frame. It will be same as like matrix, but in matrix you are not able to give the like dollar symbol or anything like that, but in data frame you can certainly do that. So what we'll do is, let's say you have created this data frame 1, and you want to access it based on the column name. So you have to give the country, data frame dollar country. You remember we have given a country column. Okay, country, GDP, population, right? So let me access it. So if I'm able to like run the code, particular code 231 line, so what it is giving me, df dollar country. So dollar means we want to access that particular variable. So whenever you press dollar, our intelligence will give you a list of all the variables. So if you give, just see the console panel, the top bottom left, so df dollar. So in, if I'm pressing the dollar sign, I am getting three columns. So one column is customer ID, the second is product, and the third is country. Okay, so we are getting three columns. Based on that, whatever is our necessary, we can use that. Let's say country. So DF country is nothing but India and USA. Let's say, okay, let's say DF dollar customer ID. Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And whenever we are talking about ours intelligence, it is very easy. No need to like by heart any code, it will give. Let's say you have pushed dollar symbol, then it is directly giving you customer ID, product, country. So no need to write your own, directly press enter. So customer ID is selected, then press control enter. So always use ours intelligence rather than by typing your own. Okay, anyhow typing is good, but always use ours intelligence. Okay, so it will not make you make your time it will save a lot of time from your end. Okay, so this is a way you will index a particular column, and this is a way how you will see a particular column in R, like if you are using a data frame. Okay, now let us come to one more thing. Guys, are you able to hear me? Let me know.
Yes.
So let me know whenever you are not able to listen me properly. Okay, anyhow I am talking with a higher voice only, so that recording will be clearer. That is fine. So we have covered list, vector, matrix, data frame, and we are now moving on to one more data type, which is nothing but as a list. Okay, so why list? So list is very important in a data frame. Let's say in vector, what you are doing in vector, you are grouping a similar data type. Okay, but if you have added other data type, let's say in numeric you have added strings, characters, or maybe any other data type, it is becoming a list kind of thing. Okay, so in R, if you are maintaining multiple data types, so it is nothing but you are making that as a list. Okay, so list is nothing but a collection of data type containing multiple datas or categories of data within itself. Okay, so here I have mentioned the difference between list and data frame. You can easily understand what is the difference between list and data frame. So list will take any number of elements for corresponding vectors. Let's say it will take a few elements in the corresponding vector. You can add your own numbers to that. There is no boundary in list. Okay, but data frame will contain the number of elements for corresponding vectors. It will be same. Let's say country is containing 4 elements. You cannot add population column 5 elements. Okay, so it will be giving you some, like it will not make any sense. But list will contain n number of elements based on your input type. Okay, so let us say I will go through how to create a list. Just see, just concentrate guys. Okay, these all are very important. So list in R is a collection of vectors. It contains elements with multiple data types. This is very clear and concise, so you can remember. So list can contain a list within. Let's say you are adding some variable, some inputs to a list. It can contain its own list, like nested list also you can do in R. So let us try to execute this line. So X is a variable which contain multiple elements. Let's say I have used the function list. List is a function name to create a list. And what I'm doing inside the parameters, I'm just creating few vectors. Let's say A is a vector containing C 1, 2, 3. B is a vector containing Bangalore, Pune or Hyderabad or any other cities. So instead of creating one vector, we can create a list and thereby putting multiple vectors within. So let us try to execute it and just see X class of X is list. So let us print a list of X. So what we have printed out. So first is 1, 2, 3. Second is Bangalore, Pune, Hyderabad. Okay. So there is a catch over here. How you are indexing a vector that is different here in list. So indexing vector starts with a square bracket. Just try to remember. These all are important concepts. Whenever you are trying to index a vector, you are using one square bracket. But in list, as you are creating multiple vectors, you just have to use double square bracket. Okay. Double square. Just see X of one. So first vector, if I try to access 1, 2, 3, then I have to use double square brackets and then it will give me first lists. Let's say in X of one, I want like first list for like this one. And then if I go to, let's say I want a second column. Okay. Just see here, I have written already. So second list is like first and second list. Just see this line. So here what we are trying to do is we need the first list as well as the second list. So it will give you everything 1, 2, 3 and Bangalore, Pune, Hyderabad. But if you want to go inside the list, let's say in first list, I need the second value, which is 2. Let me highlight it. So which is 2. Okay, just see this one in first list. I need this two. Just see the marker I have put. So how will you do that? That is also a important thing, right? So how will you do that? You can do this by, let me delete that marker. In first list, I need the second column. Why I'm using second? Because in R, indexing starts from one. I need the second index value. So can you understand what I did? So in first list, as this is a nested list, I have gone to first list and then from the first list, I need the second element. So I have got this desired output. Let's say I need first list or second list and the second output or the first output. So it is Bangalore. Second list contains the list of city. So in that list of city, Bangalore comes in first index. So first index is Bangalore. So X of both square bracket or double square bracket 2. And then that from that list, I need the first index, which is nothing but as Bangalore. So this list and data frame is a common interview questions asked in most of the companies in during the interview, like what is the difference between list or vector? And how will you identify list and vector, or how will you identify list and data frame or vector and data frame? What is convenient to use in your project or in your data set? Guys, are you following me?
Yes, Devi.
Okay. Any doubt till now?
No.
No, yeah, cool. So you have to make yourself comfortable in these data type, because these are widely used or will be used a lot in your modeling algorithms. So whenever you will get a data set or whenever you want to do some manipulation in the data, these concepts will help you a lot to manipulate, to access a column, to read the data or to do anything. I mean to say, to do anything, you have to get familiarized with these concepts. Okay, so you can change the names of list also, like let's say name of X. These all are like I have already done. So name of X and X. So what I have done is, so the number, like number and city, like city.
Your voice is breaking. I am unable to hear you. Hello. Hello.
Those things that also you
Hello.
can do so that it will be more interpreted. Tell me. Yeah, I'm able to hear you.
No, from last 1 minute to no audio from your side.
Are you able to hear me?
No.
Yeah. No, your voice is breaking means like there is no breaking, but then this.
Last 1 minute audio was not there.
Last 1 minute I did not talk any much, like much talk. Just listen. Can you decrease your sound volume? Someone, you decrease your sound volume. So list is finished. So anyway, whenever we do the data manipulation in the next classes, so we'll talk more about these data types. Okay, this is just overview of data types. And anyhow, I prepared all the documents for you people, so you will find no difficulties. Just you have to practice a lot. Okay, so let us discuss something more on the data frame side, because this will be widely used in your projects or coming learning. So how will you combine two data frames? When we talk about data frames, it's nothing but a SQL table. Okay, so how will you combine those tables if required at some point of time? So let us discuss that. Okay, so it is nothing but merging of two data frames with the same columns by using rbind. Okay, so rbind is a function. Let me tell you, rbind is a function in the R program, okay, built-in function which will add number of rows provided that you have the same number of columns. So let's say you have 100 rows and the next load is happening today and you get some more data with respect to your old data. So you, what you can do is you can combine the data frames by using rbind function, and this is widely used. Okay, so let's say we have created data frame 1 and data frame df and df1 already. So now what we can do is we can create one more variable, all_data_frame, whatever you like, you can give the name. Do not confuse yourself with your naming convention. Whatever I follow, it is not necessarily mandatory that you need to follow. You can give your own name and rbind of df and df1. So let us execute this thing. So did you get this error? Why we get this error? Can someone tell me why did we get this error? Errors in rbind, numbers of column argument do not match. Guys, did you get this error? Why are we getting this error?
Where is that input data, Debi? DF and DF1.
Yeah, DF is just C.
Okay.
Having customer ID, product, and country. DF1 is having.
So the columns is not matched, right?
Exactly.
So that's why.
Yeah, exactly. So that is why you have to debug also in industry. Debugging also helps a lot. So why it has given error is the number of columns are not matching. So what is the solution for this? What do you think? What would be the solution? Either we have to
delete that,
column,
or else we need to add one more column.
Yeah, exactly. So what I'll do is I'll go to the data frame. Okay. DF. Okay. DF is okay. So I was doing some more other things, so that is why it has been replaced. Okay, so I have to execute these things again. Country, GDP, control enter. Now again, this thing. Now DF1 is this. Now it will work. Did you know how I have done that? So did you get? I have executed the old code because we are using the old code, like last class code. So based on that, it is doing. So now it will work. Okay. Just see all dear. Did you get the concepts, guys? So here we are doing a R bind across all the columns, and whatever I have added in the data frame one, based on those columns, those already got appended by using R bind function. Okay. So R bind is nothing but collecting two data frames across the columns, or across same columns, and rows will be appended top to bottom. But let's say we have got one more requirement with respect to columns. If you want to use, how will you do that? There is one more concept of merging the two data frames with different columns. So you have, like, let's say in data frame you have got age, salary, and then you have some more columns in other data frame. So how will you combine those two data frames? So in that concept, you have to use cbind function. Cbind is nothing but column bind. Okay. So let's say I have created one variable rank which contains 1 to 12 values. So let's print rank, and then I'm just making it as a data frame. So rank is nothing but a vector, but I'm just changing the class, because here in data frame you have to change the class. Okay. So I have changed it to data frame. Okay. Now if you put all df, what is all df? Earlier we have this Netherlands, like country, GDP, population. Last time we have built using R bind. But now let's say we want to create another data frame which will contain this all df columns, all the columns, and new column whatever you created is, it's a rank, like rank of the country based on the GDP, population. What is the rank for the particular country? So just cbind all df and df new, which contains the rank information. Now see, did you get the concept? So this is another column we have added, rank column. Okay. Highlighter. Okay. So this rank column is added. Just see, this column is added to the earlier data frame we have got. And now we are able to see this rank as a different column altogether. Okay. So final data frame becomes country, GDP, population with its rank. Let's say India is having more GDP, or it's a rank 1, and Sri Lanka is rank 6, and Pakistan is rank 9. Okay. Guys, are you following me?
Yes.
Yeah. Good to hear. Okay. So these all are very important concept when we talk about this data types. Okay. Now with this new data frame.
Hello. Hello.
Yes. Yeah, Ram.
There is a given rank, right? So it is having all values. Suppose if the values are one less, then what it will come? Means total is the right. If up to 11 only you save.
Okay. No. Just understand. This one you have given, or the business will give. This is a vector we have created, and we are just appending. Let's say in this there is no concept of one or two, like increasing or decreasing. This is a rank you have given to the particular country. This is a one other column altogether, and the columns will be having the same number of entries, and you just want to append the same column to the entire new data frame. In that sense, you have to use cbind.
Okay, there will not come it missing value like that.
No. Missing value. If you have missing values, then you have to anyhow do that. But let's say if you want to add one column to your data, then cbind will be the function you have to use. Data might contain missing value, Ram. That is correct. But if you want to do these things, then you have to follow this. Let's say if you want to add more columns to your data, then you have to use cbind function. Okay. Okay. There is no concept of like sequence number or that. This anyhow will be given to the business. So remember that, guys. Remember one thing. These all variables are defined by business. Nobody can touch this business. Here, this we are learning. That is how we have created this data. Data you are not going to create in your projects. Okay, so you will get the data from business, or maybe those will be lined any of in the archived server, or maybe in production server, or maybe in testing server. They will dump the data, then they will send it across to you. Then from there you will start your own analysis and understanding the data, then data mockups, and then drilling, and all that you will get to know, okay, subsequently. So this is, we are learning. That is why we have created our own data set. Are you following? Okay, yeah, good. So now let's say in this new data frame, always try to know that there is a class concept, okay, class of all new data. So try to find this, what is the class of that particular variable or like the object you have created. So the all new data frame is a type of data frame class. Now let's say you want to put some constraint to the data and then try to visualize the data. So it is like filtering condition in the data frame. So how will you do that? So get me all the country which has greater than 100 population. So if you see this data frame, the entire data frame, which is a country having more than 100 population?
What is the question, Devi? Sorry.
What I'm saying is, get me all the countries which have greater than 60 or 100 population. So how will you filter that? You know, filtering condition in SQL.
Whatever the condition, any one condition.
Yes, yes, exactly. So I have given the condition like, so you anyhow know this concept. Earlier I have explained you. Okay, so let's say 60 population. So all new data frame, then square bracket. Then if you want to access a particular column, you have to use all new data frame and then dollar symbol. Do not forget to use dollar symbol in data frame. Dollar will give you all the column names. So based on your required interest or required variable names, you can use your condition. So all new data frame population greater than 60. And then you want all the rows, all the columns also. So condition will be given on top of rows, because anywhere data is being stored row wise, you remember those concepts. So whenever you try to give any condition, you just try to give this as a row concept. Okay, so all underscore new data frame, whenever you try to give square bracket. So remember, there is a comma in between. So first, before the comma, this is rows operation, and after the comma, it is column operation. You have remembered last time, we have discussed all these things in detail. So whenever you try to impose one condition with the data, so try to impose it based on the row wise, so that you will get all sorts of information, whatever you need. If you put column wise, then rows will be missing. If you are not giving the condition. Okay, so just try to like understand this concept pretty well. Okay, so whenever I'll execute this line, so what I'll get the population greater than 60, including all the columns. Okay, and let's say I need only first column. I do not need population greater than 60 and all the rows or all the columns. I need whatever is required based on the column level I need. So first column, let's say country details I need. Whatever population greater than 60, we need across only country column. So you can give your country column as one. So the population greater than 60 country column is India, USA, Australia, Netherlands, and New Zealand. Okay, so you got this information. But it is always wise to do the first scenario. Okay, like always we need all information. Okay, but based on your requirement, you can do that also. And you can give the country name also. Like here we have used one as a column name, first column, but rather than that, I can use country directly also within quotes. That also will be giving me same answer. Okay, it also gave me same answer. Okay, And directly also I can use this one. Okay, like without comma, if I press, just see, after the 260 line, I'm going to 263 line. Direct, I'm not giving any comma. So I'm not concerned about the tabular information. So it will give me a kind of list it will give. Okay, so just see, if I execute this, just it will give India, USA, Australia. But I will recommend you to write like this, the first 260 line, so that you can give it get a feel of tabular information. Okay, guys, are you getting me? Okay, thank you. Yeah, these all are pretty basics, but let me tell you, if you are going to any other, like any other source of information, or so, nobody will teach you this basic things. Okay, directly they will jump onto data frame list, but I'm giving you everything from scratch. Okay, so you just try to learn these things so that when modeling you do not face any issue. Let's say we are moving to modeling and in R you are not comfortable, so how will you understand the modeling concept and XSI data frame or XSI data set? So that is why make sure that after we start the modeling, you just be familiar with R. Okay, so let us move forward. Difference between list and data frame, just try to memorize this, or maybe understand the concept and then try to cover up these things. So nothing difference. The main difference is list will take any number of elements for corresponding vectors, but a data frame will take equal number of elements for corresponding vectors. Okay, so that is the only difference in list and data frame. Okay, so today we'll discuss more on, guys, please make sure that you are understanding each concept. Whenever you are not understanding, just raise your hand. Okay, no, do not make yourself confused by the time.
What is the difference in number of elements in the sense?
In list, okay, in list. So what is that list? So see, just list is list of, let's say you are creating one vector C of, let's say first is 1, 2, 3, and then Y of C, Y is equal to C. Guys, why am I giving C concat function? Can someone tell me why am I using concat function? Let's say they be then three. Okay. So is that answer you are thinking? Is it correct exactly? Think once more. Then I think Saranya, then Mithun. Okay, so probably if you see this list, let's say any vector, okay, list is equal to this. So list of this means in first I have 1, 2, 3 elements, but in the Y vector list, if you populate this, just see, first vector is containing 3 elements, but in the second vector I have entered 4 element. So list will not bother how many elements you enter, but in data frame you have to have the same elements in the data type. So let's say all df new, all underscore df underscore, or all df. So here you see country, GDP, population. Whenever you have created country, you have entered 12 elements. GDP also is having 12 elements. Population is having also 12 elements. So you cannot enter in country 8 elements, in GDP 12 elements, or in population 3 elements. Okay, this will give you a mismatch error. Okay, that is the basic difference. Did I answer your question, Ram? Okay, these all are interview questions. Okay, just try to make yourself familiar. So let us move on to univariate analysis, guys. Okay, this is kind of statistics part, but this is pretty important when we talk about the data analytics. So today also we are discussing more on to statistics. Yeah, good question. So C is, we are trying to give multiple elements, that is where we are giving C. C means combine operator. I told you, combine or concat. Concat means we are giving multiple information. That is why we are giving C. Let's say one. So one is the output. But say I need 1 to 10. So we have sequence 1 to 10. Just see. But let's say I'm giving 1 to. Three. Just see. You're getting my point? 1, 2, 3 we cannot give. So C of 1, 2, 3. Just see. So whenever you try to give multiple combination of elements, so use concat function, or you have sequence operator or colon operator, or let's say sequence. Okay, sequence of 1, 2, 10. It will also give the same output. So did you get the difference why you are giving using combine operator to get multiple elements into one? Yeah, thank you. So let us discuss univariate analysis, guys. Gayatri, are you following?
Yes, Debi.
Yeah, cool. So let us discuss univariate analysis. This is a part of statistics also, but I'll cover statistics as well as R coding so that you people do not feel boring kind of thing. Do not feel boring kind of thing. Okay, so I will mix both the things at some point of time, statistics, then we can move on to coding part. So you will get a mixed blend of both the things. Okay, so let us discuss univariate analysis. What is the meaning of that univariate analysis? So whenever you try to analyze only one variable out of your data set, that is known as univariate analysis. I'm repeating, whenever our interest is to understand one variable at a time, that is known as univariate analysis. So if you take one example of let's say average price of a Bangalore IT engineer or any of the IT specialist whoever is working, so in this scenario we are concerned about the salary of Bangalore engineer or maybe any people who is working in an IT sector. So we are more concerned about the salary part. So that is why we are only dealing with salary at the point of time. Whenever we do this analysis, this is nothing but univariate analysis. Uni means one, variate means one variable. So whenever we try to analyze one variable, that is known as univariate analysis. So did you remember we talked descriptive statistics and inferential statistics with the branch of statistics? So that descriptive statistics is nothing but univariate analysis we are doing. Okay, and it contains how many types of observation or and then histogram and outliers. So we discussed everything in detail last time, but today we'll be discussing how to do that. It is always like imperative to know how will you do that in R or any other language. Okay, so univariate analysis is containing the calculation for mean, median, mode, histogram and outliers. Okay, but the more we will see in mean, median, mode. Histogram and outliers are nothing but to find the distribution of data. Okay, so let us discuss that in R. How will you do that? So let us see, let us create variable. Okay, let us create a variable of random wherein you are running 5000 this thing numbers. So run if means R unif is a function available in R to create random numbers in uniform distribution. So I have just created a variable. Okay, you also can create after the class, and let's see what is there in random. Okay, what is there in random? Okay, just see, we have received around 5000 entry, but the R is optimizing it up to some extent, then others are omitted. Okay, do not worry a lot why it is omitted, because in the console panel there are fixed memory, so it cannot give you all the output. So that is why it is omitting around 4000 entries. So now to find the distribution of data, we can use one function which is nothing but a histogram. We see the distribution of data in the first or second classes, like it is a right skewed data or left skewed data. Did you guys remember those concepts? Yeah, so whenever we try to see that in R, there is one function called histogram, which is nothing but will give you the complete graphical scenario how your distribution will look like. So just see, can you see this part? This part? Highlighter part? Just see what we get. We get the salary of, let's say, salary of engineer staying in Bangalore, and then the frequency of their salary in the y-axis. X-axis will contain the salary of the engineer staying in Bangalore, and the y-axis will contain the count for the, like, how many it is, how much it is, the frequency. You remember the frequency we have discussed. Try to memorize those things or recall those things, okay? So here, let me make you understand how the code is working. So random is a variable we are using. Then we have given you, we have given some concept of breaks. Okay. So here the data, like the data we are getting is around 5,000. So if you are not using break, then this page will not be able to fit the entire graph. Okay. That is why I have given breaks in between, so that 0 to 0.2 will be in one group, then 0 to 0.4, it will minimize the data somehow. Okay. So that you can see the graph. So in this histogram, we can identify that these 5,000 values of the salary part of Bangalore engineers is being spread across the space or the sample space. It is quite, what you can say, the uniformly distributed. So almost all the data is uniformly distributed. That means we have like the salary is somewhat same throughout the space, because you can see the height. Just recall our second or third class, salary is somewhat same across the height, just this height, just I am talking about this height. So you see this height, this is almost similar. There is no peculiarity or peak or low or high or low in this. So we can say that almost all the average engineers or most of the engineers are getting the same salary. Let's say in between 6 to 6200, all of them are getting salary. Okay. Guys, are you following me?
Yes, Debi.
Yeah. So here I have one question. So what do you think? What will be the mode over here? What do you think? What will be the mode over here? I'm just deleting. Anyone can answer. If you are not able to, also just guess something. What will be the mode? Just remember that this is the count or frequency of the element. Guys, please respond. What will be the mode over here? Can I repeat the question or what? No, Ram. 90 is the count for that. Yes, exactly. 0 point, somewhat this line. Just try to see. This line is the mode, because this has highest frequency, like this peak. Mode is nothing but the number of highest frequencies occurred in the data. Okay, these are very, very important questions. So when we talk about this line, 0 point something, around 6 point something, or 0.7 around, we have the highest peak. So 0.7 will be our mode. Okay, because this y-axis is nothing but the count, like how many times 0.7 has been repeated in the histogram or the salary part. So salary of, let's say, 7 lakh is achieved or is received to a particular engineer most of the times, around 90 times in the data set. That is why this 7.7 would be our mode. Okay, yeah. So one more thing, what histogram first is, histogram is nothing but the univariate analysis, which will give us the distribution of data, whether it is right skewed or left skewed. So in this histogram, is it right skewed or left skewed? In this kind of histogram, just see, I am zooming it. Let's say we are zooming it. So what do you think, guys? Is it rightly skewed or left skewed?
We can't say like that, Devi. Here we can't see.
Yeah, it's uniform. It's Ram is saying it is uniform. Because we have taken the function of run unif. Okay, I'm just closing this out. Yeah, you just have to be serious. What I am saying is just deleting. So here, just recall this thing. I have used run unif. So if I'm using run unif and I am plotting a histogram, then no matter whatever be the data, it will be a uniform distribution. Or you can remember that binomial kind of binormal distribution, when we talk about the distribution part in the first or second class. I'm not recalling, just infer those recordings, okay, or go to those recording. So this is a uniform distribution. Almost all the salary is uniformly distributed, and this is a code. So let's say you want color as blue, then you want to put X lab as salary, Y lab as count, and main is my histogram. So whenever you try to use this function, it will give you this histogram. And always remember to save this. Okay, this export option is there. Can you see this export option? Save as image, save as PDF. Why? Because in industry, we often have to use or present these histograms to the business. So let's say we have done something and we want to represent those things to the business, so we can easily use it in our presentation. I usually do this. Okay, so try to use it in your presentation. Always save this. So now say I have created one more variable. Let us discuss one more level. So I have created one more variable, age, and I want to see the age. Now can you tell me whether it is right skewed or left skewed?
Left skewed.
It is normally distributed, Gayatri. Like, just see. Patrick, yeah, absolutely, Ram. So just understand the concept. Just see, normally bell kind of scenario. Okay, just see this. It is looking like a bell, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So Gayatri, I'm giving one few example where you can understand what is right skewed or left skewed. Okay. Let's say the average salary of an engineer staying in Bangalore, what do you think? It will be right skewed or left skewed? Just use your like analogy behavior, use your intelligence in your mind. Salary starting from 0 to, let's say, 10 lakhs or 20 lakhs, what do you feel? It will be right skewed or left skewed?
If you are using at right side more salary means left skewed.
Yeah, that is correct. Yeah, that is correct. It is given on this condition, your answer is correct. But in a general overview, salary will be always right skewed. Okay, that answer is correct. But what I'm trying to ask you is, salary will be always rightly skewed because you have salary ranging from zero towards the more, let's say, in most of the condition. So always you find that, like, let's say 20 crores or let's say 3 crores or 5 crores towards the end of the salary, there will be very few people. So if I'm drawing this, just see, just understand my, so you have salary starting from zero, then you got some pick, then you towards the end you will be seeing like this. Are you able to follow me? So this is the highest salary is a variable in your data set. Okay, so this is the, this will start from, let's say in this 10, 15 lakhs, 20 lakhs, 25 lakhs, 30, 35. Let's say this is salary column. Let's assume that. So you will get 35 lakhs as very, very few, like in general scenario, I'm telling. Okay, so this will be a quite good example of salary as a right skewed salary, a right skewed histogram. But let us talk about what will be a left skewed in common cases. What would be a left skewed? Left skewed. Just think. Like can you explain me, Ram, how weight will be? You are talking weight. No, we are not taking only one variable. This all are univariate analysis, right? Age and weight, only one variable. So you mean to say age, right?
Yeah, if you consider both variables.
Okay.
Yeah, one and left. Yeah. Means what can we do?
I got it. So you are taking weight, right? You are talking about weight. So how will you understand weight? So let's say, like, I'm not getting your concept, like how you are explaining me, like weight will be, let's say weight is going from this, like zero from 80. But
two variables again. If only weight,
sorry?
It will not. No, I thought if age and height, age and weight.
No,
that won't work. That, only weight
no,
won't work.
Yeah. That will not work. So let's say one example. Only one means premature birth. Premature birth. This is one common example. So if you talk about premature birth, the frequency of a baby born in 3 months, 4 months, or 5 months. Let's say we are taking the like number of months premature babies, a number of months in y-axis. Always consider in univariate analysis when you are using histogram, you just consider the one variable premature birth with the number of months and the frequency in y-axis. So the count for the premature birth will be very less. Okay, so it will be always left skewed, like left tailed graph. So first you'll have like very few counts for premature birth, like most of the births will be normal birth only, like 8 months, 9 months. So when you move towards number of month, let me draw it out so that you people can understand. Just see, when you move towards number of months, so let's say this one is first month, this one is second month, this one is third month, fourth month, fifth month, sixth month. So first month premature birth will be very, very less. Then this second month, it is also very, very less. The count will be very less. It is almost zero. Then third month, it is also very less. Then fourth month, it is somewhat growing, but it would be very less. Then up towards, it will go peak. So this graph looks like left tailed, right? Inclined towards left. Are you getting the concept? Are you getting it? Yes. Gayatri, are you getting it?
Yes, Debi.
Okay, so this is one common example. So try to memorize this concept and with respect to one example, so that any question can be asked in interview. If you are going for 1 year or 2 year experience in data analytics, they might ask you this kind of things to test your level of confirmation with respect to everything. So these are very, very common questions asked in many interviews. So can you give me one example of left skewed data? So you can say that whenever we talk about premature birth, the data will be always left skewed. Why? Because we have very less count for premature birth when we are growing towards the date of delivery. So if it is zero, like first month, then the count will be very less. Then if it is second month, then it third month, ultimately we are delivering most of the times in 9 months and 8 to 8.5 to 10 months. So whenever we have 8 to 9 months, the count, the peak will be there. So it will somewhat left skewed. Then right skewed would be whenever we are going from low salary to high salary, in most of the cases, we find a right skewed or right tailed histogram. Okay. Is this clear?
Yes, Devi.
So one more importance of histogram is it will tell you which is the outlier. Okay, so let's say, guys, what is the meaning of outlier?
It will outlier is nothing, it will give the data between two values, excess of
which is not common for our
common for,
which is not
yes.
Common. Yeah. Yes, exactly, which is a strange input with respect to all other observation. The outlier is very different to a common observation or very strange to common observation. So let's say in the age variable, I have added two outliers, like I have added somewhat 999 and 1000. Okay, so it is possible that we can get this. Let us execute as age. Now age, just see. Can you see this graph? I'm zooming it off. So just see, I'm just will highlight it. So our graph is like this, like the shape of the graph is like this one. Okay, so it is somewhat rightly skewed, but here easily by using the histogram we can see that this is the outlier because this has less number of occurrences, or maybe very less. It is very strange to what we have. Most of the data lies in this region, most of the data, and in this two we are having outlier concept, but we cannot say that up to what extent the outlier is. For that mechanism, we can use box plot, which we have already discussed. Okay. Histogram will tell you which is the outlier. Let's say here 800 might be outlier, 1000 might be outlier, but up to what level you can define that outlier, that can be done by using box plot. Because in box plot, we are setting the boundary. But in histogram, we are not setting the boundary, but preliminary observation, we can use histogram and then see that what is outlier. So here in this graph, this one is this range is outlier. Just see, I'm marking it out with the highlighter one. This 800 to 1000 is having very less input based on the frequency. Just try to see the frequency level. 800 to 1000 is having almost close to zero frequency, or one frequency, one time it has appeared, but rest of the other data is being cultivated or encapsulated many a times. Okay, so groupism, group wise, it is having a less inference, so it is a outlier. But if you want to know up to what extent the outlier is, we have to use box plot. Okay, why I'm saying this, guys, is because of the reason that 800 is repeated around one time and 1000 is also having repeated one time. So which one you will decide, 800 is a outlier or 1000 is a outlier? This is the biggest question. You cannot say that 1000 is only outlier and 800 is not, and 800 is the outlier and 1000 is not. That you cannot decide because there is no limit or boundary specified in the histogram function. So to do that, we have another methodology or box plot mechanism, wherein the function will give you the outlier concept and which is a particular outlier. and how will you discard those outlier? That we'll see. Okay. So these, in this histogram, you will find 1 to 2 question. Okay. Basic is 1 question and max is you can get 2 question. Like how, like to see the data distribution, how, what will you do in your data set? So you can say that I will use histogram. So to see the data distribution, whether it is rightly skewed or left skewed. Okay. Based on that, I'll do the data analysis first assumption. Okay. Guys, are you following? I'm repeating again and again. Are you following?
Yes, Debbie.
Yes, yes. Thank you. Thank you. So I have made all the comments, so you can always read this. There is nothing to prepare. I have already prepared enough thing for you. Okay. So all the comments and all that here, it is written. Okay. So no need to prepare anything from your own. Just try to practice a lot. Okay. So here I have written histogram do not help us identifying outliers. Using mean and median all the time for univariate analysis will not give the clear picture. Okay. So if you are using mean and median always, it will not give you clear picture. Mean will be the simple average and median will be the 50th percentile. Okay. So it is our duty to use histogram and see the data distribution. Okay. So we have understood that mean median concept, which will always not help you. Okay. So histogram will let us know where our data is going, how we are going to visualize the data. So I have prepared some notes for you. Just see, I'll share it again. No worries. So just see. So can you see my screen, guys?
Yes, maybe.
Yeah, so this is prepared by me anyway. So just concentrate on this concept. Anyway, we have discussed already, but then I'm just reviewing it. So how our data is distributed, the skewness, asymmetry across the space, we have to understand that. So either it will be left skewed or right skewed. Okay, so it is nothing but a graph which will see the data distribution. Where is the outlier? Which data is being an outlier would be captured by the histogram. Okay, just remember this concept. Then code is already we have discussed. Okay, so there is nothing much in it, but I have a question for you. Okay, just we'll discuss. That is an interview question. So outlier also I have discussed. So the data that is different to other data, histogram will allow us to find out the outliers in our data. If you have outliers in our data, then the graph will be a scaled inclination towards it. Just see this, I'm just using this. So if you have outlier, the graph will be like this, inclined one. Just see. So from this region to this region is our outlier. Are you getting, guys? Whenever the graph will be, whenever you use hist function and the graph is inclined towards the tail, this is the x-axis and graph is touching the x-axis. So from this starting point, wherever it starts touching the x-axis and toward the end will be most of the time outliers. But as I said you, we cannot distinguish who is the outlier in this graph. We have this point 100, 110, 120. So 120 is repeated around 5 times or 0, maybe 5, and 110 is around 10 and 90 is around 15. Let's say you cannot say that 90 is outlier or 100 is outlier or 115 is outlier. You cannot say that all of them can be outlier. Maybe some of them can be outlier. So to know the exactness who is outlier, we are using box plot. Okay. We are using box plot and I have made the notes also. So just we can infer the notes. Okay. Okay. From histogram, we'll not get the exact boundary of outlier. Up to which extent the outlier estimated is the question. That can be covered by box plot. Okay. So today we are touching the box plot also. Now is the question. Okay. I have made you enough understanding, so let us discuss regarding box plot. The question. Anyhow, the answer is there. You can see the answer, but then I will recommend you to just do not look at the answer and just try to give me the answer. Okay, do not see the answer, guys. In this graph, whatever is there, this is a histogram of salary and the count. Okay, anyway, count is not there. Just see the count. Any what is the count? Okay, just see. I have made it. So what do you think in this graph? The question is, mean is greater than median or mean is less than median? I am repeating the question. In this graph, this is a right skewed graph, okay, as it is inclined towards the right. So in this right skewed graph, mean is greater than median or mean is less than median? What is your answer, guys?
Mean is greater than median.
Yes. Ram, what is your answer?
Mean will be less than, I think, because divided by so many things will come, right? 1 to 100 will come. So median only highest plus next higher by 2. If it is middle, only one. So median is less than. Mean is less than.
Yeah. We'll discuss that. This is pretty important question. So we'll discuss that. No worries. So median is 50th percentile of data. Ram, it is not the middle number. It is a 50th percentile of data. So let's say here it is 50th. So this entire 50th percentile will be your median. But to answer this question, Gayatri is right. Okay, Gayatri is right because we have given one example. So the first you have to understand is understand the question. What I've told you, I have already told you it is a right skewed graph. Here it is written. I have repeatedly told you this is a right skewed or right tailed histogram. So if it is right skewed, what will happen? There could be many outliers inclined because it is inclined towards the right and we are touching the x-axis. So there might be many outliers which is not common to the normal observation. So here what we'll get? So this 10,000 salary, 20,000. So in right side, you might get, let's say, 1 crore salary. And let's say 2 crore. Okay. So what will happen? I have just made, say, 10 lakh, 20 lakh, 50 lakh, 90 lakh, and 1 crore. Just take this as an example and then you will understand. Okay. I have given the example also. So what will be the mean over here? Mean will be nothing but 125,900 by 5, which is nothing but, I have not calculated exactly, but you can calculate it, something around 21.5 I have roughly estimated. So it will be something like that, 21.5. But what will be the median over here? I have sorted it out. Median, in the sense, we have to first sort the data, then you have to find the middle most point. So 50th percentile of data, which is nothing but as 5. So mean is 21.5 and median is 5. So whatever I have asked is, what is greater than mean is greater than median? That first answer is correct. Why it happened? We have to understand why it happened. Because we have added one outlier to our data. Just see what is the impact of outlier in the data. You can understand right now. Just see, by adding this outlier, I have shifted my mean towards the outlier. I have 1, 2, 5 and 9. But then whenever we added 100 in the data and then we try to calculate the mean, so it is highly affected by the outlier, which is not at all good. But Did the median got affected by the mean, by the outlier? Just see. Did the median got affected by the outlier? No. Median did not get affected by the outlier. Okay. So it is the middlemost or 50th percentile of the data. So 5 is the median. Okay. But 21.5 is the mean. Now you understand how outlier can impact your data or impact your analysis.
So this 1, 2, 5 and randomly you taken, right?
Yes, so randomly
taken like that only. So what are the okay? So
no, no. For understanding purpose, I'm making some
outlier.
So it is common
while
to all
observations.
Yes, yes. So what I'm trying to make you understand is whenever you have outlier or right skewed graph, towards the end you have let's say few outliers in your data, so mean will be always greater than median, and it will be affected by outlier, which is not good for your data. Okay, so this kind of question might pop up in the interview. So in this condition, what will be your let's say you have some null values and you want to impute or replace that null values with mean and median, what will be the median?
Median.
Absolutely correct, absolutely correct. So happy. So why I have discussed, now you understood, right? Let's say in the salary part you have n number of data points, but some of them are missing, and most of, let's say towards the end you got many outliers. So if you are having some null values, so you have to fix something, right? Because salary you cannot keep blank. Okay, you have to do the analytics also. So salary part you cannot keep it blank. Okay, so if you have any option to impute those values, null values, as the like any other stuff, so in numerical columns you use this concept, mean, median, mode. Okay, so what will be your preference? Because mean is affected by outlier, so no, I'll not impute, because the data or analytics will be going wrong, and median will be not affected by outlier. Always remember that median will not be affected by outlier, because median is the 50th percentile of data. You are not adding anything. Okay, towards the end, if you are having outlier, you are not adding, you are just ordering, and then you just try to find the middlemost point. Okay, so there will not be any affection with the outlier, so median will be your answer. Yeah, so did you find this question interesting, guys?
Yes, Devi.
Yeah, this is nothing but concept only, so I have prepared that for you morning. So just this kind of question will be popping up. Okay, so let us move forward. We have discussed like close to 40 minutes with this, 30 minutes. So now histogram, I have given n number of example. Now let us come to box plot, guys. This is pretty important. So guys, do you want one break or what, like for 2-5 minutes? Okay, cool. Then you just, no, I you like, I mean to say, just relax for 2-3 minutes and revise the things or make your mind cool. Okay, because we are discussing for more than 1.5 hours, so just relax for 2 minutes. I'll be back. Okay, just give some time to yourself also. I'll be back, guys. Okay. Thank you. Shall we start, guys?
Okay.
Yeah, I just having some water because last like close to 1.5 hours I've been talking, right? So I was having some distress. Okay, so cool. So let us discuss about box plot. So there is nothing to discuss in box plot. We already have enough discussion. So just to give an overview of box plot. So histogram is not giving any strong assumptions on outlier for a data set. That is why we are moving to one more concept as box plot. Okay, so box plot will give us a idea where is our outlier, so that you can discard those outlier based on your business requirement, because outlier is not at all good for your data. Just to remind you, outlier is not at all good for data, but at some point of time you have to see whether to use it or discard it. Okay, if it is salary as outlier, then you can earning a lot in the company. Most of the employees will be earning in the range like 10 to 30 lakhs in Bangalore or 40 lakhs with the same year of experience. But you will hardly find one person with the same experience who is earning 3 crores or 5 crores in Bangalore only. It is also there, but these numbers are very rare. But if you talk about road accident, okay, road accident, or number of people using their debit card in a mall or credit card in a mall, so the swipe machine or the amount they swipe is huge. At some point of time, somebody can swipe around 15 lakhs from the same credit card. Okay, for somebody might use 5 lakhs from the same credit card. Okay, so in this case, you cannot say them that whoever is swiping 15 lakhs is an outlier. No, the business is, it is their choices or it is their need at that point of time why they have used it. Okay, so you have to treat the outliers based on your business scenario. Okay, it is not like we'll always delete the outliers, not like that. Okay, just to give you an higher overview. So to get the exactness of the outlier, we use box plot, because box plot gives us a boundary values to decide who is our outlier. Okay, so we have already created a random variable, guys. So I am assigning that random variable to our x new variable. So just I'm executing this. So what is there in x? Just see x. So a random variable. So run uniform distribution, run of function I have used. So 5000 values are there, ranging from 0 to 1. Okay, so in outlier you have used concept of quantile, right? First quantile, like 25th quantile, 50th quantile, 75th quantile. You remember, guys? Please respond. You remember those concept, quantile concept? Q1 will be 25th quantile, Q2 will be 58th quartile, Q3 will be 75th quantile. So we have to write the function quantile x of 25th, 0.25 I have given. Just see the code. Okay, after the class also you can remember or recall these things. Then Q2 is something, Q1 and Q2, Q3. I have just executed. Then IQR I am finding out. IQR is what? Q3 minus Q1. This is normal mathematics I am doing, just using R. Okay, now what is our upper limit? Q3 plus 1.5 IQR is the upper limit. What is our lower limit? Q3 minus 1.5 IQR is the lower limit. So let's say upper limit I am executing, Q3 plus 1.5 IQR, Q1 minus 1.5 IQR. Okay, so now how will you eradicate or discard, delete, eradicate your understanding, right? Or discard, I'm just renaming, or exclude. Okay, exclude the outliers. So to do this, you can use one more variable, x new, create any vector or variable, whatever it is, just use x as the data frame, because x is a data frame. Class of x is what, guys? Let me know. Class of x, okay, it is numeric, but then you can access it also like data frame also. It is the same concept, but in data frame you are accessing through dollar symbol. Here it is a vector, numeric vector, so you can use the square bracket and give upper limit, x less than upper limit and x greater than upper limit. Okay, now x new you'll execute, so print x new, x new. So here there will be no outlier. Okay, so it is doing internally. Okay, just to explain you the code how I have written, this is a concept. Let's say this question might be asked, so you have to create one quantile, first quantile, second quantile, third quantile, quantile 25th, quantile 58th, quantile 75th. Okay, then you have to create one more IQR variable. IQR will be Q3 minus Q1. Then you have to set the limit based on the statistical measurement. First limit, upper limit is Q3 plus 1.5 IQR. Store it as a variable, upper variable. Then lower variable, Q1 minus 1.5 IQR. Then you discard through based on the concept. What is the concept? X should be greater than upper, less than upper limit, and X greater than lower limit. Lower limit is 1.5. So up to lower limit and less than higher limit. So in between whatever is there, you just see. Now you see box plot S new, box plot X new, X new. So see, is there, can you see the screen, guys? Now see, in this graph there is no outliers exceeding to our limit. This is the highlighter. I just see this is our limit. Most of the data will be resided in these two radii. So this is our 50th means Q2, this is Q1. Now you recall those concept, Q3, this is, this range is what, Q3 plus 1.5 IQR. IQR, this is Q3, Q1 minus 1.5 IQR. Are you getting, guys? So above this, let's say above this, these three are there, and below this, these two are there. So if you use box plot and you write the code based on the upper limit and lower limit, now nothing will be there. So this is, there is no outlier, no outlier. Guys, are you following?
It never show outlier, right? If you use their under condition, it never show. Because
yeah,
already
yeah,
we are.
Yes, exactly.
Already we are neglecting them.
Yes, yes, exactly. So we have treated those things by our code, whatever automated code we have written. So let me close this. So we have already treated.
We can't able to say what are the outliers, right?
Absolutely, we can say that also. I'm going down. You can see many examples. So let's say this is a code you have to use for. This is a piece of code I have written for you to exclude outliers. And finally, you print the box plot. Let's say, let's do one more example. I have made the code very easy and with enough examples so that you people do not waste your time. So let's do one more example. So let's say x1 is 1 to 100, then x2 is 500 to 1000. Okay, now I'm just combining x1 and x2. X is equal to c of x1 and x2. So what will be x? Let's see, x is 1 to 100, then directly minus 500 and 1000. So just see, this x2 is outlier. I'm adding outlier to the data. Here I'm manually preparing the data. Okay, so x1 is somewhat normal, 1 to 100, then x2, just see, I'm added, you can understand, minus 500 and 1000. You can easily know that these are outliers. Then I'm just combining both of them, print of x, then box plot. Just see, can you see the screen? So these two are outliers, around 1000 and minus 500. Can you see, guys? Just see this one. This, so just see how it is doing estimated. This is a like Q3 plus 1.5 IQR. This is Q1 minus 1.5. Whenever you add something which is not common to the data, it will give this one. So whatever piece of code we have written earlier, now you can use the same piece of code and try to minimize that. I will do that for you. Okay. Now just see the same. You can use the same code. Earlier I have explained you code. Now you just how to get rid of outliers. The same concept. You just put the boundary. Whatever is our boundary, like less than, it should be less than 500. You can define that boundary also based on your use cases or the kind of data you have. You can define that. So in this common example or example, I have made that like higher boundary less than 500 and the lower boundary greater than 100. So if I'm using X new and condition, now box plot will be having no outliers. Just see the new box plot will having no outliers. Okay. Guys, is this clear? Yes, thank you. So try to memorize this concept. Do not always remember the codes. Anyhow, I am sharing the codes, whatever I have written for you. So understand the concept is more important rather than the codes. So here I have made everything possible for you.
Yeah, can you go up the slump? 313. The condition again, right? Okay. Upper X less than 500 again, right? So in place of that, so if we go in project, manually you have to calculate and after that you have to give upper limit Q3 plus 1.5 into IQR. That value you have to give. It will take only this condition you have to give. X less than upper limit. X greater. Okay.
Yeah, absolutely. It will work. Okay. So this is automated code I have prepared, but this one, if you are giving this concept manually, if you are adding the data, then you know what is the data, right? Let's say here it is well known that 500, 1000, and we can easily see that the data is minus 500 and 1000 is outlier. So directly you give the condition or else you can automate it. So I have written that automated the same process to eradicate or exclude. Okay. The same. Yeah. Or discard. Okay. Okay, to prepare this file, it took around 10 hours to 12 hours. Okay. I prepared it somehow like few months back, but then it contains everything. And I am making you sure that you will not get this kind of automated things and this kind of questions anywhere in Bangalore. Okay. So we'll talk that offline. No worries. Okay. So let us discuss standard deviation. I think in the code, that one is Gayatri mixed. So standard deviation is nothing but how you are seeing the variability of a variable with respect to mean. Higher the variability means the higher the standard deviation. Okay. So standard deviation is what? Measures of spread or center. Guys. Yes. So there is no concept of standard deviation without there is no topic in statistics which will not cover these terms: mean, median, mode, standard deviation. So if you are not clear with these terms, then you are going nowhere. So try to understand these concepts, and later on you'll feel that how this will help you to understand your data. So standard deviation measures the variability of a variable with respect to mean. From mean, how far it is there. Okay, so it is the root mean square of deviation from its mean, and like we have already seen the example sum of xi minus mean of x by the n, where I is 1 to n. So just I am going to execute. So probably you can execute the same thing. If you are pressing the question mark and SD, it will give you the understanding of standard deviation, how it is. So you can read it out in the help panel. Now you can use standard deviation H and na.rm is equal to true. Okay, by na dot rm, here there is no na values. So I'm giving you one more example. Na values, Gayatri was not there. So Gayatri, whenever we have any data as missing value, we call it as na values. Okay, so whenever you calculate anything or standard deviation mean, so you have to treat na dot rm as true. If you are not treating that na dot rm is true, then there will be no calculation happening. Okay, so na dot rm means remove the na values and calculate, exclude the na values and calculate. Okay, if you are not using this, then it will give standard deviation as na. Just see age, let me add na value, let me add or na value. Okay, now if I am not using na dot rm, just see standard deviation became na. Why? Because we contain any one na values in our data, which is as null in SQL or database. So it is our duty to impute the na values with some values. So if you are not imputing, what you can do is na dot rm is equal to true. By default it is false. Okay, Gayatri, are you getting?
Yes, Debi.
Yeah. So anyway, NA like NA is how important is NA value in our data. When we go to data manipulation is the next class we will talk. That is a separate class. Okay, tomorrow we are discussing those things in terms of a data set. I'll be explaining everything. Real world will be manipulating the data. Okay, so tomorrow is we are having a lot of fun with the data. Okay, so let us discuss more things in terms of concepts and all that. So distribution we have seen, right? So how will you define uniform distribution? How you can see that? So uniform distribution is not like the distribution will be spread like not uniformly. There is no disruption in the distribution. So we have seen that variable, right? That one, what is that? Age. So age or some graph we have seen today, right? So it was uniformly distributed like that. Let's see, this is uniform, this and this. So most of the data will be this. So height wise, if you take the frequency, it will be uniformly distributed. Okay, so how you define? So distribution with slope zero. In technical, distribution with slope zero, there is no slope, inclination is not there. So this line, so this line is having slope zero, right? It does not make any angle with respect to the frequency. So the slope will be zero. Here if you talk about bell curve or any other, so slope is somewhat inclined, so it might have 10 degree, 20 degree, but in uniform distribution the slope is having 0 degree. Technically someone can ask you in the interview. So distribution with slope zero is known as uniform distribution. Okay, just remember that. And frequency of distribution remains the same. This frequency level, this frequency is same, the count, this count bar y axis, it will be same because you are in this data are uniformly distributed, so frequency will be same. Try to memorize those things. Then we have triangular distribution. Okay, triangular distribution, it's like triangle kind of scenario. As the name suggests, histogram of this distribution will be a triangle. Okay, if you take histogram of this triangular distribution, it will be like this. Okay, here we have a mean value, like minimum value, maximum value, and the peak value for distribution. Like peak will be this, mean will be this corner one, then right one will be max. These are concepts. There is nothing to worry about modeling and all that. These are basic concepts which will be often asked in interview. What is a triangular distribution? Okay, so there will be one peak, first one. There will be one minimum value. There will be one maximum value. If our data follows this kind of distribution, then it will be a triangular distribution. Okay, can someone tell me what would be a triangular distribution?
Uh, And the distribution is like triangle, a set we call as triangular distribution. Means example you are asking?
Yeah, exactly. I'm asking one example. Can you give me one real world example where the data will follow triangular distribution? Just think and tell me. Real world, I am not asking you variable, what is the data set, just give me one example. Like I explained, the premature birth will be a left skewed graph. Like one example, you give me which example follows triangular distribution.
We can take a trade market.
Trade market will be multi-pick, right? Multi-pick, like you have highs and lows, those will not be triangular, right? At some point of time, it is triangular. Might be, let's say election is coming, let's say after the election result, it will be triangular, minimum, then pick, and then again after the election, suddenly go down. But that will be very rare. You are getting my concept. You have seen that once Modi government has been elected 2014, the share market took a like very very big towards it is going to heaven, then after that it is somewhat going down, right? So
yes,
it is correct, but then it will not be triangular all the time.
Okay.
Yeah, can you just think it off and just let me know in the group so that I can answer you people what will be the exact. So do not, we are not going to like discuss so much about it, but then you just think it off and answer in group. And let us discuss now about normal distribution, guys. So normal is, as you know, it is a bell curve. When you draw a histogram, we get a bell curve, and it is known as normal distribution. Normal distribution is the common mean, and wherein we have mean and median will be at the same point, like same point. Okay, so here what is the input you are getting in, if you talk about the technical description of it, y is equal to f of function of mean and sd. Sd is standard deviation, okay, sigma, which is denoted as sigma. Okay, so the function will take mean and standard deviation or sigma, which will give you a plot of the like normal distribution or bell curve. Okay, so anyhow, I have the codes also that I can share you, but then like we'll discuss it later. Okay, for this time it will be very very overburdening to you people. Okay, so why we need a normal curve today, I'll let you know the main concept, the technical concept of normal distribution, why the real world follows the normal distribution, today we'll discuss. Okay, and this is very very important question, 100% important question asked in interview. Okay, so from now onwards, or from starting onwards, whatever is important question in interview, I have been repeating n number of time for you people, and I have been discussing those things around 10 times to you people all the time. So try to conceptualize those things from now onwards, because after the course ends and you don't know how something is working internally, then you are going nowhere. Am I making sense, guys?
Yes.
So try to, I have been repeatedly telling you these things from the first class, even the class starts, to you and Ram, whoever it is, I have been repeatedly telling you, please conceptualize those things pretty well. And I have been giving you answer also in a different way several times. Okay, so try to do that. Okay, so why the real world follows normal distribution, and why always we take normal distribution? The reason behind is, if you go from mean one sigma or one standard deviation away, you will capture 68% of the data. This is industry proved, in the statistics it is already proved. Why we take the normal distribution when we are taking y is equal to f of mean and standard deviation? Okay, so I'll go to one notepad and I'll try to explain. Okay, this is very important. Okay, so let's say this is a graph, And normal distribution means somewhat it will be look like this, right, Gayatri or Ram? This will be looking like a bell curve. So
yes,
here our mean and median will be the same. Okay, this is a mean and median. Okay. So from mean, if you go one standard deviation away, it will cover 68% of data. Means how much you did your data has 100%, it will cover only 68% of data from both the sides, from 1 sigma mu plus minus 1 sigma, okay, plus mu plus minus 1 sigma, 1 sigma, sigma is like this, okay, it will cover 68% data. If you go two standard deviation, it will cover how much? It will cover around 90, like close to, like I have to minimize it anyway. So if you go 2 sigma from both the side, if you go 3 sigma, it will cover, let's say it will cover everything. So here you just understand this point and this point. If you go this 3 sigma mu plus minus 3 sigma, then it will cover around 99.7% of data. Okay, that is why in industry everything runs in normal distribution, because normal distribution contains this mu 6 sigma concept. 6 sigma means 1, 2, 3, means 3 plus 2 plus 1. Sigma wise, I'm telling you. So first sigma, second sigma, and third. So 3, 2, 5. So mu 6 sigma concept. So it will contain most of the data. Okay, so you will not ending up losing any information. So you will contain 100% of the data by following this mechanism. So one example I'll give. In industry, have you ever purchased like any soap or maybe any deodorant from any of the store, right? Correct? Guys, are you listening?
Yeah.
So you have purchased something, right? Like Lifebuoy or any deodorant or maybe whatever you want from the grocery store. Let's yes, I'm there, Ram. Yes, I'm there. Hello?
Yes, Devi. No voice still, yes. Now, from past 1 minute.
So what I'm saying is, if you are buying something, so industry uses this concept, mu plus minus sigma. Okay? So 3 sigma up to 3 sigma level, they will go to attain their customers. Because 3 sigma will be having, so based on their capturance level, they will estimate the price. They will not increase the price too much, or they will not decrease the price too much. So they will maintain this rule to hold their customers. Now you understand this concept? Did you understand this example, whatever I've given?
Yeah.
Yeah. No. Ram, are you able to hear me? Now you are able to hear me?
No, can hear.
Yeah, that's what I'm telling you. In industry, this mu sigma, mu plus minus 3 sigma concept is there. So first sigma, or like let's say mu plus minus 1 sigma, if you go, it will capture 68% of data. If you go towards 2 sigma plus minus, then 95%. So you need entire data, right? You do not want to lose. So up to 3 sigma, it will contain almost all the data. So whenever you want to purchase something, or the price, or let's say Facebook wants to retain its customer, so they will use this methodology to capture everything, because they do not want to lose any information. That is why normal distribution is in normal distribution, most of the real cases. Okay, so if they are asking normal distribution how it works, so you can say like normal distribution is widely used, and the mean and like standard deviation is the function whenever we try to calculate, and it uses mu plus minus 3 sigma to attain all the data. That is why you use normal distribution always. Did I get your did you get your answer? Okay, cool. So let us discuss joins in R, guys. So probably joins in R is the most important thing. So you already know how to join data frame or databases across several tables. So it is also the same, but the cost, like interpretation, is somewhat different. So joins in R, we do joins data frame by using merge function in R. Okay, we have function called merge. How to join two different data, like two different data frame. So joins is pretty much required, right? If you have enough resources or enough data sets, so you have to consolidate everything or collate everything based on the business requirement transformation. Then after, you prepare one data frame by joining everything. So that is why join is very, very important or necessary part in data manipulation. So that is why let us discuss. So here I'm creating a data frame. So data frame function is data dot frame. Then I'm creating a customer ID by using concat function. So C of 1 to 6. Then I'm creating a column called product by using a concat function and repeating HP for 3 times. And I'm repeating bear for 3 times. So let's use data frame. I'm just creating, then print this. So just see, customer ID and product has been printed out with respect to this data frame being 2 columns. So I have repeated HP thrice, bear thrice. Then let's create one more column, data frame 2. This is nothing but customer ID and the same, but here I have mentioned 235 customer ID, and I'm just repeating India and USA 11 times. Now just see, so what you are getting, customer ID is common to both the data frame. Now we want to join the data frame so as to get the data. Okay, so here it is also same inner join. Okay, inner join is nothing but joining based on primary key with the matching data across both the tables. So if you merge this, merge of data frame 1 and data frame 2 by customer ID. Okay, so just see what we get. Customer ID 235, because 235 is only matching, then product HP HP, and country is India USA. You can create your own example also. Here you can give merge DF1 DF2, or else X is equal to DF1, Y is equal to DF2. Whatever your choice, you can give. Okay, no worries in that. Both the quotes work fine. If I'm using this code also, the data will be same, output data. Then left outer join. What is the meaning of left outer join, guys? Left outer join. Guys, please respond.
It will give the all matching data from the left side and non-matching from the right side, right?
Yes, yes. It is the same, but here the concept is you have to give some parameters, okay? The meaning is similar. It will give full left table data and the matching content in the right table. And wherever the key is not matching, let's say you are not matching with the key, then the data will be giving NA values, because the data is not matching. So it will print NA. There is no value, null values. Okay, so just try to execute merge DF1, DF2 by customer ID, all dot x is equal to true. Why all dot x is equal to true? Because we want full left table. Left is x dot x. So this is the parameter you have to give, all dot x. If it is a right outer join, then you have to give all dot y is equal to true. Are you getting, Ram? Yes, yes, Ram is getting everything. So happy. Okay, cool. So right outer join is same. So just give all dot y is equal to true. Now I can execute the same thing. Here the matching right and the full right and the matching data from left. So you can give the, so wherever it is not matching, so it will be giving NA. Outer join means give everything. It is kind of full outer join. So here the concept changes. Here you have to give all is equal to true. It will give everything, all sort of combination. Okay. So if you execute, it will give everything. Customer ID 123456 HP, and then country is this one. Okay. So we have discussed the merge operation whenever the column is similar or the column names is same in both the data frames. I have customer ID as name or column, the preferences joining column. But what if you do not? Yeah, go ahead.
You have written right, India, you written one times and it came for two times. So we have to use a repeat function.
No. Repeat function is, I have. So product C of repeat. Just see what it, how it works. Repeat is a function. Let's see how, what you want to repeat. Repeat Ram. Ram.
How many times?
For five. Let's say, comma, seven times. Okay. So this is just, I'm creating a data frame. That is, I have repeated. Okay.
Any package you have to import or any library?
No. These all are built-in function. There is no package. I have not installed any package till now.
Okay.
Or in built-in function. And by the end of this course, you must have got around 50 to 60 packages with your use. In modeling, we hardly use 10 to 15 or let's say 20 packages. In R, we have 5,000 packages. Okay. So there could be several user defined function, there could be several built in function, there could be what you can say, like package function which is scoped in package only. So in our scenario, we hardly use around 15 to 20 useful packages, and these packages are very, very useful in modeling. So we will discuss that probably tomorrow or when the modeling starts. Okay, probably next. Next week we'll start the modeling. So if we are having different column names, so we have to rename those column names, or else we have to use by dot x or by dot y. Let us try to execute this. Let's say in df2 I have this concept or customer number concept. So earlier we have customer ID, and here this data frame contains customer number. So how will you do? So see the column names, use the function called call names, guys. Okay, call names df1. Okay, call names df1, call names df2. So see, in df1 we have customer ID and product, in df2 we have customer number and country. How will you join these things? So either you have to change customer ID to number, or number to ID, whatever you wish, or you use this below concepts, this the merge of data frame f1 and f2. By dot x is equal to customer ID, and by dot y is equal to customer number, and all dot x is equal to true, because you are, this is a left outer join. Okay, so R will understand that you are using by dot x as customer ID and by dot y as customer number, both means the same for R, and all dot x is equal to true. Okay, so this is going to give the same output. Okay, wherever there is a match, it will print or then NA if it is a left outer. But if you do not want, you can change the call names like I did. Column names, just see, call names, customer number, country. So here call names is customer number, country. So I'm changing df2 as customer name or country, or df1 is df. Let's say df1. I can change this. Okay. So I can do that also. So you can do this also. Here I have written, just see this one. This four lines of code will be working for you fine. So columns DF1 and first as customer ID or DF2 as customer number, whatever you like, you can do this. Now you can merge. Okay. So if you are changing the column names, there will be no problem. By is equal to the number of the name of the column, then you can use it. And here also in merging, after the merging, you can customize your data by using some functions, filtration. So let's say I want the customer having not having a laptop and not having HP as product, okay, without Bayer. I have changed the codes just now morning. So just see df dollar, just try to memorize. Whenever you try to access a column, you have to use dollar symbol, and it is equal to, assignment is double is equal to, okay, you are comparing, right? So HP is having one row of information, country, GDP, population, and DF is Bayer is same thing. Okay, so you have to understand not is equal to Bayer is, you have to give. If it is a HP one, you have to give is equal to HP. Okay, based on that. So you just try it out at your home. Okay, any doubt just ping me, no worries. Guys, is this clear till now?
Yes, baby.
Okay, so I'm not going too far details, because anyway, when we start modeling or data manipulation, we'll be covering those things. So today it is in depth for this concept, and whenever we do data manipulation in tomorrow's class, we'll take a data set and try to manipulate something based on the data, how these things will be doing. Okay. So now let us discuss about the scatter plot. Okay, we have one plot. Okay, scatter plot. Scatter plot is how your variable is spreaded across the space. It will give you a plot. Okay, so as I explained over here, the points for both x and y, age and salary, are scattered across two dimension. Okay, so age is one dimension and salary is one dimension. So you can see this how it has been spreaded. You can see by using a plot. So we can draw this by for numerical variables. Okay, so you can use this. Okay, so here there is rnorm function which will allow to create a random number. Also you can create rnorm function to create random, but I am just using this age as a column and salary. Okay, so let's say age we want let's see, I have executed. So what is the age? Just see, age is, we need, no, why scatter plot? There is no concept. Yes, important is if you want to see the data in two dimension in the space, you just need scatter plot. Let's say age and salary, you give age and weight. So you want to see the data right in plot, so that visualization can be helpful for your like understanding, data understanding. Okay, how you see histogram? Yes. How you see histogram, Ram? No, two variable. Okay, two variable only you can see, right? How you can, it can be spreaded across the space. It is not one variable. Yeah. So how you see histogram? If you see the histogram graphical representation, this is very meaningful, right? So that you can represent that to business, that plot, colorful plot. So visualization of the plot is very, very important with respect to business. Okay, so let us create one variable, age. So random numbers, or like random normal distribution. R norm means random normal distribution. It will follow a normal distribution. Okay, so if you see hist of age, isn't it a normal distribution, guys? Gayatri, this is normal, right? Normal distribution. The, yes, just see this one, the bell curve. Okay, this is normal distribution, normally distributed, because I have used the function R norm. Just see R norm function. So histogram, we have created one age, and then hist of s, then salary. Salary also we are creating. Salary also, salary is uniformly distributed, let's say. Okay, salary is uniformly distributed. So run if 100, we need 100. Okay, 100. So salary is, let's say, print this out. What is the salary? Salary. Salary is also 100. We need 100 salary ranging from 0 to 1. Okay. So now we want to plot. Okay, plot this one. So it will be scattered across the space. Just see. Plot age salary type is equal to L. Okay. Then X lab is S, Y lab is salary, and main is scatter plot. Okay. Just see. This is normal plot. Scatter. Just see. Wait. No worries. What is that? You are asking me any question, guys? Go ahead, ask. No worries.
That R norm is given, right? 3 parameters you are passing. 150 to 20.
Okay, 50. Okay. So this is the is R norm. Okay, so let's say I need 100 numbers. I'll go to the documentation. Okay, so that you can understand R norm. Just see normal distribution. Okay, so here everything, whatever is your doubt, you can ask directly. So R norm is nothing but you are giving a width total number of 100, and based on each 50 it will increase by 20. Okay, so here, is there any given references for example? Okay, so this one is age. Let's print this out. Okay, so just see how it has been calculated. 30, 31, 31, 47, 63. So with the, it is kind of a break in histogram. What we give a break in histogram, that is nothing but a R norm min. So we need 100 numbers around, and it will be ranging from 20 to 50. You are getting, Ram? So highest range will be 50. With the breaks of 20, starting from 20, it will go to 50. So it will not exceed 50. Just see. Hello?
Yeah, but the value of the 56 are there, 59.
20 to 50, 100 numbers I need. Minimum is 20, max is 50. In between these two ranges, it will give me 100 numbers. Just see, it is random, you cannot see, but it is starting from 20 to 50 values. I need 100 numbers, the range it has given. Okay, this is I have given.
Okay. 75 also there.
Sorry,
maximum should be 50, right? As for you, maximum value.
Hundred numbers. Okay. Earlier it was giving 50, right? Like maximum is 50.
There are the values.
Just hold on. Maximum is 50. 61. Okay. So starting from it is 106 also, right? It is having 106 number also. Okay, maybe I have not seen that anyhow. It was long back, like, so anyway, I'll let you know. No worries in that. There is no, like, nothing big difference in here. So we need only 100 information, and then there is no, like, nothing to worry about. So maybe the technical documentation holds some other values. So here there is no, I usually do not remember codes. That is what, okay. I'll get back to you, no worries. Okay, anyhow, this will hardly take 5 minutes. So this function, but I know as far as it's only me, but then let's see. Okay, no worries. So histogram, if you print age, it will give you the values, and then salary of, if you give runif of, let's try this one, what it contains.
I think call is there again.
Okay. Yeah.
Look.
Gayatri's call is there. Okay. Cool. So let us wind up. Let us wind up for today's call, and probably we'll meet sometime tomorrow. But Gayatri and Ram, could you please come down tomorrow? Because I need at least one day to physical interaction, and the one day will be online. Why? Because this has got some benefits for you people. So every time online is not good at this point of time. Okay, so one day you should come within week, and other day you can join online, no worries. Okay, because next week I'm starting modeling, so you have to understand the physical interaction and the description part. So you just have to take a stretch. Probably one day you can come, have to come. Okay.
Devi will meet next week.
This week you are not meeting?
Today I'm going to hometown.
So tomorrow? That's,
tomorrow, that's why. This weekend I have to be there. That's why.
Okay. So probably what I'm requesting you people is from next week onwards, do not, at least for at least midweek of Jan. Do not go on the weekends. Maybe at times you can go, but then I will request you to not to go to like hometown if you are missing. If it is a completely online class, that is fine. But modeling wise, why I'm requesting is you have to understand the mathematics behind it. So every time I cannot explain all the mathematics behind it in this online call. Okay.
And yeah, next week we'll meet. Surely.
Yeah. Next week you can probably start, because from next week I'm starting modeling.
Okay.
And what you have, just like ask in the group or discuss in the group. Kindly be proactive in the group so that you clarify your doubts in the group. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you, Devi.
Thank you.
Bye. Bye. Thank you for your time. Okay.
Thank you. Bye.
Yeah. Thank you.